Hi viewers, this is Jay Swami, Assistant Professor of Zoology. In this class, we are going to discuss the sliding filament theory, which explains about the mechanism of muscle contraction. The sliding filament model explains muscle contraction by the sliding of thick and thin filaments, myosin and actin filaments, over one another and the changes that occur in the bands and the zones when a muscle contracts. All of them contribute to the sliding filament theory. Sarcomere is the unit of the muscle contraction. Shortening or contraction at the level of sarcomere reflects the contraction of muscle as a whole. When a muscle is stimulated, all sarcomeres in the muscle become shorter and the distances between the Z lines decreases as the myosin or thick filaments of the muscle fibers slide past the actin or thin filaments. As a result of sliding, the length of I band and isotropic band and the H band is reduced, while the length of A band and isotropic band and the length of both thick and thin filaments remain unaltered, unchanged. The length of the sarcomere is shortened by 30 to 60%. 30 to 60% of its original length. Sliding of the filaments over one another results in shortening of the muscle that leads to the muscle contraction. There is nothing but the muscle contraction. The sliding filament theory was proposed independently by Andrew F. Huxley and Rolf Niederjerke. They are from University of Cambridge. Another group of scientists, Hugh E. Huxley and Jean Hansen from the Massachusetts Institute of Technology in 1954. So these two group of scientists, they proposed this theory independently. Sliding of filaments occurs when cross bridges are formed between the myosin binding sites on actin of thin filaments and the myosin heads, otherwise heavy myosin of the thick filaments. That leads to the muscle contraction. If you compare the relaxed state of muscle and the contracted state of the muscle, here you can observe the blue color one is the myosin and here red color one is the actin. Center it is the H zone. So here there is a enlarged H zone in the resting condition, but here the H zone is reduced due to the sliding of myosin and actin filaments one on the another, and thereby here the sarcomere length is up to this much, but here only this 30 to 60% of reduction we can see. The same thing is happened here. This is the H zone, but here you are looking like a line only. So it also explaining the relaxation state of the muscle and the contraction state of the muscle. Here also you will see the red color one is the myosin, surrounded by 6 filaments of the actin. So 2D representation and the 3D representation. In the sliding filament theory, what happens? There is a excitation and contraction coupling. Excitation and the contraction coupling mechanism takes place, where you can find out excitation contraction coupling is the mechanism by which action potential in the sarcolemma causes the release of calcium ions. An increase in calcium concentration in the sarcoplasm promotes the formation of cross bridges between the actin and myosin, resulting in the sliding of filaments and contraction of muscle fiber. At rest, the myosin binding site on the actin, they are masked by the tropomyosin. Let us see in the image. So here, whenever the muscle in the resting condition, myosin binding site on the actin filaments, actin molecules, that is masked by the tropomyosin, the thread-like structure, pink thread-like structure. The binding sites are unmasked, that is tropomyosin is removed only when calcium ions bind to the troponin C. As we know, there are 3 subunits in the troponin molecule: troponin C, troponin T, and the troponin I. When the calcium ions bind to the troponin C, then these myosin binding sites on the actin molecule, they are get unmasked. That is, tropomyosin molecule is get removed from the myosin binding sites on the actin. The calcium ions are stored in the sarcoplasm reticulum. Membrane of sarcoplasm reticulum contains voltage-gated calcium channels, which open in response to change in the membrane potential. On the arrival of the action potential through transverse tubule, otherwise triad, calcium channels open, and calcium ions flow out from the terminal cistern of the sarcoplasm reticulum. Calcium ion binds to the troponin C, causing displacement of tropomyosin from the myosin binding sites on actin, and makes the binding sites of actin available to heavy miromyosin of the myosin molecule, so that cross bridges are formed between the thick and thin filaments. The heads of myosin project out in all directions from thick filament, and each thick filament is surrounded by 6 thin filaments. Just now we have seen like this. Each myosin molecule surrounded by 6 thin filaments, and cross bridges are formed with all 6 thin filaments. Each myosin head binds and detaches several times during the contraction, acting like a ratchet to generate tension and propel the thin filaments to the center of the sarcomere. So like that, there are the cross bridge formation takes place in between the heads of the myosin and as well as the actin molecule. So this cross bridge goes like a cyclic manner. There is a cross bridge cycle where myosin head not only has a site for the binding to actin, but also it has a site for binding to ATP and ATPase activity. So here you can observe here it is a actin binding site of the myosin head region. This is the ATP binding site and here ATPase enzyme is there that hydrolyzes the ATP into ADP. After the formation of the cross bridge, the events may take place. What are the events that takes place in the cross bridge cycle? The first and foremost one is the ATP binds to myosin heads, cause the detachment of the myosin head from the actin. This is the first step. Second step is the ATP hydrolysis. Myosin head energized, ADP still attached to myosin head. Third one, energized myosin heads bind to actin, form cross bridges and pull thin filaments towards the center of the sarcomere, causing shortening of sarcomere, that is known as the power stroke. This is known as power stroke. Next one, bound ADP is released and the myosin heads are ready for next cycle, next cross bridge cycle. Finally, binding of fresh ATP to myosin heads causes them to detach from the thin filaments. This cyclic process is repeated as long as the Ca2 plus ions and ATP are available in sarcoplasm, causing shortening of the muscle. For relaxation of the muscle, what would be the condition? Calcium ion should be pumped back into sarcoplasm reticulum and ATP should attach to myosin heads. The attached ATP causes detachment of myosin head from the actin thin filament. If ATP is not available, for example, after the death of the individuals, the myosin heads remain attached to the actin thin filaments and the muscles remain contracted. This stage is called as a rigor mortis. Later on, we will discuss about it. After cessation of nerve impulse, calcium ions are pumped back into the sarcoplasmic reticulum by the calcium ATPase at the expense of energy and the muscle get relaxes. So, then come to the excitation and the contraction coupling mechanism. Excitation and the contraction coupling mechanism. What happens in the muscle contraction phenomena? Here you can find out a neuromuscular junction, NMJ. This is the neuron. And here it is a muscle fiber, neuromuscular junction. So in the inset, we will see the neuromuscular junction here. What happens in the neuromuscular junction? First step, what happens is arrival of an action potential at the terminus of the presynaptic motor neuron induces opening of the voltage-gated calcium channels in the presynaptic membrane through which calcium ions rush into the neuromuscular junction. Second point, second event that occurs here, calcium ions cause the fusion of synaptic vesicles containing acetylcholine and its release into the synaptic cleft. So here this is the synaptic vesicle and here it is the ACH, acetylcholine, release of ACH into the synaptic cleft that takes place here. Then acetylcholine binds to the ligand gated acetylcholine receptor in the muscle plasma membrane here. So these all are the receptors, causing the opening of the channels. The resulting influx of the sodium ions produce a localized depolarization of the muscle plasma membrane, leading to opening of voltage gated sodium plus channels and generation of an action potential. Then when the spreading depolarization reaches T-tubules, it is sensed by voltage gated calcium channels in sarcoplasmic reticulum, releasing stored calcium ions into the sarcoplasm. So here you can visualize all these four events. So this is the muscle actually, and this is the neuron, presynaptic neuron. So from here the action potential travels in the form of the acetylcholine that is released into the synaptic cleft that is attached to the receptor of the membrane, and thereby there will be an opening of the sodium ions, depolarization, action potential takes place, and thereby due to the calcium ions, the T-tubules, thereby voltage gated calcium channels, and the calcium is stored and released into the sarcoplasm. So here this is a sarcoplasmic reticulum, and these all are the calcium ions. So here same thing, action potential from the presynaptic terminal, and that is entered into the neuromuscular junction, and the sarcolemma get depolarized. Calcium channels that is open into the sarcoplasm that releases the Ca2+, then diffuse the calcium and diffuse from the sarcoplasmic reticulum to sarcoplasm. Then these calcium ions bind to the troponin C, and thereby tropomyosin unmasked from the myosin binding site of the actin, and thereby the actin and myosin filaments, they interact with each other and form the cross bridges, and due to the formation of the cross bridge, all these actin myosin filaments, they slide over one another and they move towards the center of the sarcomere. These are the events which are taking place in the muscle contraction. Then same thing, depolarization motor end plate coupled to muscular contraction. Nerve impulse travel along sarcolemma and down T-tubules to cause release of calcium ions from the sarcoplasmic reticulum. Calcium binds to troponin and causes position change in the tropomyosin, exposing active sites and actin. Permits strong binding state between actin and myosin, and contraction occurs. ATP is hydrolyzed and energy goes to myosin head, which releases from the actin. So these are the things to be done in a cyclic manner. So stepwise, acetylcholine is released from the axon terminal of motor neuron and binds to receptor in the motor end plate. This binding elicits an end plate potential, which triggers an action potential in the muscle cell at the neuromuscular junction. Then in the second step, action potential propagates along the sarcolemma and down to T-tubule. Here, due to the propagation of the action potential, the action potential triggers the calcium release from the cytoplasm, sarcoplasm reticulum. This released calcium bind to troponin C and exposing the myosin binding sites due to the unmasking of the tropomyosin from the myosin binding site on the actin. Cross bridges are formed between the actin myosin proteins. Cross bridges cycle begins. Then tropomyosin blocks myosin binding sites. Muscle fiber relaxes. So these are the things to be happened. The same thing, molecular events of the muscle contraction. Motor neuron axon releases acetylcholine. Acetylcholine diffuses across the synaptic cleft in between the presynaptic neuron and the postsynaptic end plate membrane, muscle membrane. This stimulates the sarcolemma. The impulse travels over the muscle fiber surface and down the transverse tubules to the sarcoplasmic reticulum. Calcium ions diffuse out of the sarcoplasmic reticulum to the sarcoplasm and bind to troponin C. Tropomyosin moves and exposes sites on the actin filaments. Actinomyosin forms the linkage cross bridges. Actin filaments are pulled inward by myosin cross bridges. This is nothing but the sliding filament theory. Muscle fiber shorten as contraction occurs. Here there is a neural control, excitation of the membranes, release of calcium ions, contraction cycle begins, sarcoma shortening, generation of muscle tension. The same thing, what happens in the muscle relaxation? Till now we have discussed about the muscle contraction, but what happens during the muscle relaxation? When nerve impulses cease, two events relax the muscle fiber. First, an enzyme called acetylcholinesterase rapidly decomposes acetylcholine remaining in the synapse. This enzyme present in the synapse and on the membrane of the motor end plate prevents a single nerve impulse from continuously stimulating a muscle fiber. Acetylcholine is degraded by the enzyme acetylcholinesterase and the muscle is no longer stimulated. And second, when the ACH breaks down, the stimulus to the sarcolemma and the membranes of the muscle fiber ceases. The calcium pump quickly and actively transport calcium ions back into the sarcoplasmic reticulum. Whenever there is a decrease in the calcium ion concentration of the cytosol, as the calcium concentration decreases in the sarcoplasm, calcium ions diffuse away from the troponin molecules. The troponin-tropomyosin complex then re-establishes its position, which blocks the active sites on the actin molecule. Following cross-bridge release, new cross-bridge cannot be formed as ATP binds to myosin head and it is not at all hydrolyzed. Blocking formation of cross bridges, and that leads to the relaxation of the muscle. So calcium ions are actively transported back into the cytoplasmic reticulum. Actin myosin linkage break, troponin tropomyosin cross bridges reform. Troponin tropomyosin interaction inhibits the interaction between the myosin and the actin. These are the two things: acetylcholine degradation and calcium ions transported back into the sarcoplasmic reticulum. These are the two things that make the efficient muscle relaxation. Then coming to the muscle fatigue. A muscle exercised persistently for a prolonged period may lose its ability to contract. That condition is called as a fatigue. This condition has a number of causes, including a decreased blood flow, non-imbalances across the sarcolemma from repeated stimulation. However, muscle fatigue is most likely to arise from the accumulation of lactic acid in the muscle from anaerobic ATP production. The lowered pH from the lactic acid prevents muscle fibers from responding to stimulation. There are various causes for the muscle fatigue. Depletion of glycogen energy stores. Accumulation of hydrogen ions from lactic acid interfere with cross-bridge function. Intracellular acidosis from lactic acid inhibits glycolysis enzymes and slows ATP production. Then neurotransmitter depletion at the neuromuscular junction. Central fatigue, that is lack of will and sleep. Accumulation of extracellular potassium ions. These are the basic reasons, causes for the muscle fatigue. So there are differences in between muscle fiber contraction and muscle fiber relaxation. Then coming to the energetics of the muscle contraction. So energetics is always deals with the ATP generation. So whenever there is a light activity, what happens? Aerobic metabolism of fatty acids from bloodstream that generates the ATP or energy. Storage of glucose as glycogen in the muscle tissue. If there is a moderate activity, breakdown of glycogen to produce glucose. Glycolysis of glucose to generate ATP and pyruvate. If there is a peak activity, anaerobic breakdown of glucose, production of lactic acid, that is a byproduct, accumulation of the lactic acid leads to the soreness. Here, there are various resources for the energy. The primary source of energy for muscle contraction is ATP. However, the muscle fiber contains ATP power only for 3 seconds. The ATP pool should be replenished as needed. There are 3 sources for the ATP replenishment: creatine phosphate. First one is the creatine phosphate. Second one is the glycogen that convert to glucose, glycogenolysis. That is, first one is the creatine phosphate, second one is the glycogen fermentation and oxidative breakdown of glucose and the fatty acids also. So these are the 3 major resources of the energetics. First, see the creatine phosphate. See here, phosphocreatine or creatine phosphate is seen as a reservoir of high energy phosphates defending cellular ATP levels. It is called as a phosphagen, as it generates the ATP. The high energy phosphate group of creatine phosphate is transferred to ADP to form the ATP by the enzyme called as a creatine kinase. So here ADP, when it is added to the phosphocreatine under the presence of magnesium ions and creatine kinase, that converts into ATP. So this is the creatine is the excreted product. The enzyme creatine kinase works in both directions: synthesis of creatine phosphate from ATP or synthesis of ATP from creatine phosphate depends on the concentrations of ATP or creatine phosphate in the muscle. When the muscle is relaxed, more ATP is synthesized by oxidative metabolism, and so the reaction proceeds in the directions of creatine phosphate synthesis. When the muscle is contracting and the concentration of ATP is depleting, the reaction proceeds in the direction of ATP synthesis. So that is, it works in both directions. However, the pool of creatine phosphate in the fiber is of about 10 times larger than that of ATP and serves as a modest reservoir of ATP and lasts only for 10 to 15 seconds. It supplies energy for bursts of heavy activity like sprinting. Then coming to the second one, this is the first one, and coming to the second one, where skeletal muscle fibers contain about 1% glycogen. Now, the glycogen is hydrolyzed by enzyme phosphorylase in the process of glycogenolysis to produce glucose-1-phosphate. Glucose-1-phosphate is converted to glucose-6-phosphate that enters the glycolytic pathway to yield 2 molecules of ATP and lactic acid. Glycogen fermentation can support muscle contraction for very short time, but it is also required afterwards to enable the body to resynthesize glycogen from the lactic acid produced earlier. The body must repay its oxygen debt. Glycogen fermentation also supplies energy for burst of heavy activity. So glycogen converted to glucose, and here two ATPs and the pyruvate molecules under the aerobic respiration. If it is oxygen available, aerobic respiration. If there is no oxygen at all, anaerobic respiration, there is accumulation of the lactic acid in the blood takes place. And come to the third one, oxidative metabolism, where most of the ATP needs of a muscle engaged in prolonged light activity are met by the oxidation of glucose and fatty acids through oxidative metabolism. Heart muscle, which has to pump blood tirelessly throughout life, depends on oxidative metabolism. So we receive energy from glucose, pyruvic acid and fatty acids. So here we are producing, generating the energy, then it is a source of energy. The same thing is explained in this table also. So it is a graphical representation of ATP store, ATPPC system, lactic acid system, overall performance, aerobic system, threshold point. There are different types of muscle contraction. Basically, there are two types of muscle contractions are there. Isometric contraction and the isotonic contraction. In the isometric contraction, iso means same, metric means length. Muscle exerts force without changing length. Sarcomere shorten, but they do not change the overall length of the muscle. The tension generated is transferred to elastic filaments within the muscle that maintain the same muscle length but increase the muscle tension. Example, pulling against immovable object maintains of the posture by postural muscles. Then isotonic contraction. Iso means same, tonic means tension. The muscle changes length and moves a load, but tension remains the same. Isotonic contraction is of two types again, concentric and the eccentric. In concentric contraction, muscle shortens during the force production. In eccentric muscle contraction, muscles that produces force but length increases. So here there are two types of muscle contraction even within the isotonic contraction. So here there are the fast and slow muscles. There are two general types of skeletal muscle fibers, fast twitch and slow twitch. So this is the fast twitch muscle and this is a slow twitch muscle. Fast twitch muscle fibers contract rapidly and powerfully, but with far less endurance. Fast twitch cells have high amount of myosin ATP activity, when enzyme that splits ATP bound to myosin more quickly than the same enzyme in slow twitch cells, because they can make and break cross-bridge attachments more quickly. Fast-twitch cells can contract more rapidly. In addition, fast-twitch fibers have a wider diameter and are packed with more actin and myosin. This feature adds to their power of contractility. Fast-twitch fibers are rich in glycogen deposits, depend more heavily on anaerobic means of producing ATP. As a result, fast-twitch cells tire more quickly. Fast twitch fibers are better suited for short periods of rapid contraction. They are more common in the muscles of legs, an adaptation for quick and rapid running. So fast twitch muscles use anaerobic metabolism for fuel, provide short bursts of speed, fires rapidly, fatigues more quickly, and it is great for the sprinters. In contrast, if you take into consideration the slow twitch muscle, the slow twitch muscle fibers contract slowly when stimulated but have enormous endurance and do not tear easily. The cells are dark and reddish because they are packed with the oxygen binding pigment, which is called as the myoglobin, and they are richly supplied with blood vessels. Slow twitch cells also contain abundant mitochondria, the organelles in which aerobic production of ATP occurs, because they can produce ATP aerobically for a long time. Slow twitch fibers are specialized for prolonged and sustained contractions. The abdominal muscles have slow twitch fibers. They do not contract rapidly but contract steadily to hold the contents of the abdomen and to balance the powerful slow twitch back muscles to maintain posture. The type of fibers in muscles may vary with training. For example, the leg muscles of endurance athletes such as marathon runners are made up of about 80% slow twitch fibers. Those of sprinters are about 60% of fast twitch fibers. So the slow twitch muscles use oxygen for fuel, provides continuous energy, offers extended muscle contraction, fires slowly, has high endurance, great for marathons. And coming to the rigor mortis, the development of rigid muscles several hours after the death is similar to physiological contracture. ATP production stops shortly after death and ATP levels within muscle fibers decline. Because of low ATP levels, active transport of calcium ions into the sarcoplasmic reticulum stops and Ca2+ leak from the sarcoplasmic reticulum into the sarcoplasm. Calcium ions can also leak from the sarcoplasmic reticulum. As a result of the breakdown of the sarcoplasmic reticulum membrane after cell death, as calcium levels increase in the sarcoplasm, cross bridges from without ATP, cross bridges are not released and the muscle remains stiff until tissue degeneration occurs. So the specialties of the rigor mortis, this is called as a death stiffness. And it is temporary, used to determine the time of death, starts within 2 hours after the death. Stiffness starts in the head, eyelids first, and gradually works its way down the legs. The body is at the most rigid state after 12 hours after the death. Stiffness disappears after 36 hours, 1.5 days. It may remain up to 48 hours depending on body weight and ambient temperature. Stiffness occurs because skeletal muscles are unable to relax and remain contracted. They are the specialties of the rigor mortis. So this is rigidity, rigor mortis. This is all about the sliding filament theory and the mechanism of muscle contraction, energetics related to the muscle contraction and muscle relaxation, fatigue and the rigor mortis too. Thank you, one and all.